Tonight's invention has had a bit of a checkered history. On the upside, it's given us mass production, advanced trauma surgery, and the royal family. On the downside, it's taken away the Barbary lion and the Tasmanian tiger. Without it, World War I would have been a bit of a damp squib, and World War II might never have happened. Its effects have ricocheted around every continent on Earth. I am, of course, talking about the gun. The gun has one purpose: to kill animals and to kill people. From the streets of South Central Los Angeles through the plains of Africa to the jungles of Vietnam, its effect has been absolutely devastating. It is a hateful thing. The gun has prematurely ended the lives of countless millions. From the organized but anonymous slaughter of the First World War to high-profile assassinations, the gun has changed the course of history in a truly appalling way. And yet, if you carry one, you win every argument. You always get your own way. And that gives you an immense sense of power. And power is an aphrodisiac. This may well be an instrument of Satan, but it is unbelievably sexy. While the gun has created some rather esoteric fetishes, it's also brought us street lighting, steam engines, cowboy movies, and even affordable cars. And the gun itself has become a major pinup. Film and TV have taught us that by carrying one, we are invincible. Which, ironically, is what gunpowder was all about in the first place. You see, gunpowder, it's said, was originally created in the 9th century as an elixir of immortality. But pretty soon, everyone realized that instead of making you live forever, it did the exact opposite. Gunpowder spread like wildfire. Eventually, it fell into the hands of the Crusaders, who brought it, along with the plague and a variety of other interesting diseases, back to Blighty. Enter monk, scholar, and explosives expert Roger Bacon. Until Bacon, the powder had to be imported, but in 1249, Father Roger worked out how to make it. As everyone now knows, you take 4 parts potassium nitrate and 3 parts of sulfur and charcoal, and there you are. Back then, though, the simplicity counted for nothing. The church, in fact, denounced it as the devil's work. However, by the middle of the 15th century, the church had decided that gunpowder was a nice little earner, especially as they had sole access to one of its main ingredients. Even in the 15th century, getting hold of charcoal and sulfur was straightforward, but potassium nitrate was another matter. The only reliable source was urine. And according to the collective wisdom of the age, the ecclesiastical urine of a bishop was by far the best. And if a bishop wasn't available, you could always try a cannon. The trouble with gunpowder, though, is that if you burn it in the open air, well, this is what happens. It just goes and ruins your tablecloth. So what you've got to do is burn it in a confined space and then channel the explosion down a barrel. A bit like this. Bloody hell! Now, exactly the same principle as that is used in every gun. Pistols, rifles, machine guns, even the gun I'm going to make for you now. What you need is some plumber's pipe, like this, anything that makes a spark, a barbecue lighter is ideal. What you end up with is something like this. Here's the barrel, here's the chamber, and here is the sparky thing, okay? Now, instead of a cannonball, what I'm going to use is a potato, okay? We can ram it into the end like so, plunge it down exactly as you would do with a cannon, and then you unscrew the back. Now, you could use gunpowder in here, but what I'm going to use is hairspray, all right? Put the back on, and that's it. Ready? Whoa! I'm going to hold up a bank. Interestingly, early guns were about as effective as a spud in a waste pipe. In 1418, we turned up at the Battle of Agincourt with longbows. The French army was much bigger than ours, but they were relying on cannons. And as a result, they missed a lot and lost. However, just 50 years later at Castillon, the gun was set to make the return match rather less one-sided. The French had busied themselves with cannon R&D and arrived to do battle with an artillery of more than 300 super sophisticated guns. And needless to say, they won. The longbow was suddenly very last year. The cannon was the new must-have battlefield accessory. And one of the first to wake up and smell the cordite was a young monarch called Henry VIII. He started a weapons building program that would make him unassailable and eventually give Britain the biggest empire the world has ever known. Their frigates bristling with cannon, the British set off to conquer the world. The only problem was that the French, Spanish, and Portuguese also had ships, cannon, and similar ambitions. So, if Britain was to rule the waves, she was going to have to blast her enemies out of the water. And that meant having better, more accurate guns. Early cannon were pretty hopeless. The barrels were wonky and the cannonballs never fitted properly. Aiming was pointless, and even if you did hit, the destructive power was pathetic. However, in 1774, an iron worker called John Wilkinson came up with a solution. His machine could drill a cylindrical tube, which meant snug-fitting cannonballs. In turn, that meant more accuracy, more power, and ultimately, more empire. But Wilkinson's tube-boring machine had another unexpected spin-off. It transformed James Watt's steam engine into the powerhouse of the Industrial Revolution. Until Wilkinson, Watt's engine had leaked. His machines were powerless and therefore pointless. But after Wilkinson, Britannia ruled the waves and had the beginnings of an industrial economy too. The cannon had brought Britain out of the Dark Ages. But what of the gun? Well, at about the time of Agincourt, it didn't show much promise. Now, this was a time way before BBC health and safety. So people had to operate them with no gloves, no ear protection, and no goggles. So let's see, shall we, what all the danger is about. This is it, hand cannon, and the idea was you put the shot and some powder in the front of the barrel, pushed it down to here, the explosion goes through the hole, lights the powder in the barrel, bang, and fires the shot down toward the target. So, let's just give that a whirl, put some more powder in there, like so. Now we have to light the fuse. This is not a gun that works terribly well on a windy day or if it's raining. The enemy coming, could you just tell them to hang on? I haven't got... Oh, no, it is lit. We're looking good. Okay, so after about 15 minutes, you're ready to fire. And to do that, you simply, if it's done from the hip like this, point it vaguely at the target and... Oh, my God! Right. Not a completely successful shot, it must be admitted. Anyway, 100 years later, things had really moved on. This is the matchlock. Now here, as you can see, the rope is already attached to the gun on this, well, they called it the serpent. And the powder is underneath this cover there. Can you see? So it doesn't blow away. Right, now, all I have to do is pull this, well, pull the cover back first, pull this, this is the world's first button-operated device, okay, pull it back like so, lift it up, and, missed again. Okay, 100 years go by again, and we end up with this. This is the flintlock. It's the kind of thing that Dick Turpin would use. Very successfully, in fact. That's why we now have street lighting, because of how many people he held up. Anyway, what you do with this is you obviously still have to load it with the shot down the front and the powder, but you pull that back. That's half-cocked. You can't fire it like that, or you'll go off half-cocked and there'll be a flash in the pan. And then there's a piece of flint here. Can you see? This is flint, that thing there. And then you push that forwards, okay, over the powder. That's steel. Then you pull it all the way back, fully cocked. The flint hits the steel, makes a spark, and bang. And at arm's length, go for the target. Well, I think it's safe to assume that while they're very powerful, they're not completely accurate.
Early guns, like cannons before them, were rubbish. Their barrels were essentially just a smooth tube, so the lead shot rarely fitted properly and would bounce around on the way out. Waiting to see the whites of their eyes was not naive bravado. It was just that firing any earlier would have been a waste of time.
Missed again.
The solution to this hitting a barn door conundrum was simple and elegant. It was an Austrian, Gaspard Koller, who in 1520 put spiral grooves called rifling inside the barrel of a gun, forcing the bullet to spin as it was shot out. The spinning made the bullet fly straight, and now we're getting somewhere. But rifling wasn't good for everyone. An Austrian aristocrat acquired an early rifle to improve his hunting prowess. He was proud of his new gun and keen to show his best friend how it worked. But his friend couldn't see what he was talking about, so a naked flame was used to illuminate the barrel. Bad move. And Austrian aristocrats weren't the only ones to come off badly, thanks to rifling. British aristocrats were busy touring the world with their new super-accurate weapons, shooting anything they could find. The rhino was very nearly wiped out by the headhunters of the empire, and the fearsome zebra variant, the quagga, was extinguished altogether. The gun was starting to make a difference.
But rifling didn't make the gun a real precision weapon until 1859, when accuracy became the obsession of a man who, it said,
had the face of a baboon.
Joseph Whitworth was a man with an extraordinary appetite for invention. He gave the world the knitting machine, a horse-drawn road sweeper, and even designs for a combine harvester. The man was an engineering god. At the Great Exhibition in 1851, his inventions, and 23 were on show, won more prizes than anyone else's. The face of a baboon, perhaps, but what a brain. He started out as an apprentice mechanic in his uncle's Derbyshire cotton mill. Young Joseph was not impressed. He complained that the workmanship was shoddy and that the machines were inefficient. This stubborn and difficult man found it all too messy and haphazard.
While other engineers of the time were preoccupied with their huge machines and their massive engines, Whitworth's world was getting smaller and smaller, until eventually he ended up designing a measuring device called a micrometer, which had an accuracy of a millionth of an inch. That's about that. Maybe even smaller.
This is Whitworth's micrometer, a machine that revolutionized engineering. Its arrival meant that for the first time, engineers could manufacture microscopically accurate machine parts, and that paved the way for standardization.
This had a profound effect, because if you think about it, before Whitworth came along, you'd build a machine, make some nuts and bolts for it. Then you'd build another machine and make some nuts and bolts for that. Nothing was ever interchangeable because there was no way of making sure everything was exactly the same size. Now, because of Whitworth, because of his obsession with accuracy, it meant you could go to the shop, get a handful of nuts and bolts, and know that whichever ones you pulled out of the bag would fit together perfectly. Time after time, after time.
Without Whitworth's belligerent quest for perfection, the Industrial Revolution might well have ground to a halt. But thanks to standardization and accuracy, machine efficiency took a quantum leap and mass production took off. Whitworth saw room for improvement everywhere, and so it was with guns. He'd already established himself as Britain's top engineer and had been asked to look into the mass production of rifles by the government. After making his recommendations, Whitworth decided to have a go at the gun itself. It was bound to be rubbish, he reasoned. It had been made by someone else. Despite its recent successes in the Crimean War, Whitworth found the Army's Enfield rifle to be wrong in every particular. So he made them another one, better, more efficient, and above all, more accurate.
Top of the target again, 12 o'clock, getting near the woodwork.
In a bid to discover how good the new gun really was, the National Rifle Association are putting it up against the Enfield that caused all the offence in the first place.
Ah, that's just outside the black at 1 o'clock.
Whitworth's rifle differed from the Enfield in just one crucial respect.
A top spins. Everybody knows that when you spin a top, it wobbles at certain speeds of rotation, and at other speeds of rotation, it is absolutely steady. And it's exactly the same in a rifle. Whitworth found that the rate of spin to make that bullet stable in the air was one turn in 20 inches, against the original government rifle, which was one turn in 78 inches.
He was so keen on his bullets spinning at the correct rate that he redesigned those too. They were hexagonal to fit perfectly in the twisted hexagonal barrel.
Well, this is the group shot by the Enfield, and as you can see, we're running from almost the top of the target to almost the bottom, and virtually across the target that big. That is a large group. And when we come over here, the Whitworth group is much tighter. The width of the group is no more than that, which is about 9 inches.
And let me give you an idea of just how accurate it was. Back then, a professional marksman using a conventional gun would reckon on being able to hit a target that was 200 yards away. But at the opening of the National Rifle Association in 1860, Queen Victoria, who preferred needlework to blowing holes in things, used one of these to hit the bullseye of a target that was 400 yards away.
You'd have thought that the British Army would have fallen over themselves to buy Whitworth's gun, but they rejected it because the bore was too small. Who knows what could have happened if the Army had used Whitworth's rifle? They certainly might have found it useful at Rorke's Drift 20 years later when the Zulus, thousands of them, appeared on the horizon. The range of Whitworth's rifle could have given the British a fighting chance. Whitworth was difficult and obsessive for sure, but he was a perfectionist. It's because of him and his ilk that Britain became the workshop of the world. But he never forgave the government for rejecting his brilliant rifle. He even moved into offices opposite the Ordnance Board, from where he would spend hours and hours glowering at the Philistines across the road, who'd committed the terrible crime of rejecting him.
Unlike so many inventors who changed the world, Whitworth did become rich. His factories were successful. And I'm delighted to say, because I really do like the sound of this guy, eventually he even managed to find a market for his guns. In America, Confederate snipers snapped up Whitworth's rifle, and as a result, we've been left with what I think is one of the greatest quotes in military history. A Unionist chap called General Sedgwick said to his troops, "What are you keeping your heads down for? I couldn't hit an elephant at this distance." But it wasn't just the generals who died on the battlefields of the American Civil War. Rifles that could kill from a distance completely changed the nature of warfare. This new technology mixed with traditional battlefield techniques spelled disaster for the troops on both sides. At Agincourt, with its cannons and longbows, 6,400 were killed. But on one day in the American Civil War, 26,000 men died. And things were about to get worse. Until this point, guns and cannons could only fire one shot at a time. You loaded, fired, and then reloaded. But that was about to change. The 19th century pioneers pushing across America were outnumbered by hordes of Red Indians. The cowboys put up a fight, but to begin with, they were losing. The Indians could fire off 20 arrows before the frontiersmen could reload their rifles even once. Faced with these odds, the cowboys needed a gun that could be fired repeatedly without being reloaded. A revolver. These days, the fastest guns in the West are shooting balloons in a car park. Chuck, from accounts, does battle with Brad and Wilbur, from marketing. There is, though, one thing that does link them to their fantasies of the OK Corral. The gun they're firing.
When you're fighting the bad guy and the Indians, and it's your life on the line, you want the best you can get your hands on. I've never shot a single action gun that I like better than a Colt.
The Colt was the first reliable multi-shot gun. Six shots in as many seconds. This new gun killed more Indians than cholera. The Colt was credited with being the gun that won the West. That led to the states being united, and that ultimately gave the world a new superpower.
Set.
But the man who invented the fastest gun in the West was nothing more than an East Coast businessman.
Gotta miss on one.
Samuel Colt was born in Hartford, Connecticut in 1814. He's revered by the Americans as being one of their great inventors, but he was actually a rip-off merchant and a show-off. When he was 20, he set himself up as the celebrated Dr. Colt of New York, London, and Calcutta, and toured Canada and the US, giving a grateful public a taste for soft drugs.
You, sir, come for this, and you'll be laughing guaranteed.
His laughing gas shows, however, weren't just for fun. The money allowed him to pursue another interest. He would pay a local gunsmith to produce the first of his prototype revolvers. Wouldn't be the last time that drugs money paid for firearms.
Yeah! I got it!
The story goes that Colt came up with his idea for a revolver while serving as a cabin boy on sailing ships.
The concept of the revolving cylinder, Sam got that when he was out on a ship as a sailor. The capstan to weigh the anchor, to bring the anchor up or down, is based on a ratchet. There's a rotating head, and inside there's a mechanism. As they turn it, we'll lock it into place, we'll turn it, and we'll click it to lock it in. He saw that, and at 16 years old, his mind was inventing. He took that concept with a piece of wood and a penknife and carved the cylinder and this ratchet concept to work a revolving cylinder.
Well, that's what they say. However, it's known that while he was away, Colt visited England, where it's more than likely he would have gone to the Tower of London and seen a gun with a revolving cylinder made by a British chap called Mr. Puckle.
The Puckle gun had multiple bullets arranged in a revolving cylinder, and crucially, it could be fired repeatedly without reloading. So, another British invention that was developed overseas. To be fair, Colt was good at marketing and used the cult of his own celebrity to shift his product.
He was able to take his guns and bring them all over the world. He gave away over 2,000 guns to dignitaries and presidents, heads of state, to promote his gun, his concept, and bring back contracts, bring back more work for Colt Firearms.
It's said that Abraham Lincoln freed all men, but it was Sam Colt who made them equal. Everyone wanted one of his guns, so he had to find a way of mass producing them. And that meant borrowing someone else's idea again. Colt didn't have far to go for inspiration. A place called the Springfield Armory was just up the road. It had been set up by the Yankees just before the Civil War. Here they pioneered the idea of the production line, replacing craftsmen with the techniques of mass production. Colt realized that if he copied what they'd done at Springfield, he could increase output and reduce costs. He was years ahead of his time. The Colt Armory soon became the world's largest gun factory, and 80% of production was done by machine, allowing thousands of guns to be produced each week. So, Sam Colt's revolver was the first truly mass-produced consumer product, and soon the entire business community began to copy his techniques. When Ford wanted to mass-produce the Model T, he based his production line on the Armory system. So, just as attempts to make better cannon had led to better steam engines, the gun, through the work of men like Whitworth and Colt, led to improvements in manufacturing and the mass production of consumer goods. In short, the gun paved the way for vast chunks of modern Western society. But then it's also made sure that there are far fewer of us around to enjoy it.
We can argue all we like about whether the gun was a good thing or a bad thing, but there is no doubt that it did change the world. And we haven't even got yet to the most important gun of them all. This. The machine gun.
Colt's revolver could fire 6 shots before it needed reloading. A machine gun could fire 600 a minute.
20 rounds of tracer from a machine gun, and half of Wiltshire is on fire. Look, 3 fires, 1, 2, 3. Now they've got to go and put it out. Sorry.
The first fully automatic machine gun came from an American inventor and part-time shepherd, Hiram Maxim. Born in 1840 to a poor family from Maine, Maxim spent a good deal of time helping on the farm. But he was far more interested in machines than livestock and dreamt of being a famous inventor. Aged 14 and doubtless bored by all the tranquility, Maxim came up with a design for a machine gun. But his uncle told him it was a ridiculous idea that would never work. Maxim abandoned the idea and went on to invent an automatic mousetrap, a coffee substitute, a novel type of hair curling iron, and a locomotive headlight. In all, he was awarded a staggering 271 patents. By 1881, he was a hugely successful engineer working on the electrification program of France.
While Maxim was in Paris, he ran into someone who said to him, "Look, you want to make a fortune. Why don't you invent something that will help these Europeans kill one another more quickly?"
It rekindled that old idea he'd had back in Maine. So he moved to London and started work once more on the machine gun.
When it was announced to the world that an American engineer had developed a gun, basically this one, which would fire at the touch of a button and then reload itself, the report was labelled incredulous.
Maxim's gun used a simple but clever concept. When bullets are fired, the explosion of gunpowder creates recoil. Maxim used the power from that recoil, the jolt backwards, to operate the machine gun mechanism itself. One man with a Maxim could shoot 600 rounds a minute, the equivalent of nearly 100 rifles. Maxim demonstrated his machine gun to interested buyers by using it to chop down trees. The British Army, however, didn't need to be beguiled with tree surgery. Maxim's gun was just what they were looking for. They'd learned to their cost that it was possible for the modern soldier with a rifle to be defeated by an enemy with spears if there were enough of them. The machine gun, however, well, one man with a Maxim could do the work of 100 ordinary soldiers. A unit of 10 men suddenly had the firepower of 1,000. Thanks to the machine gun, the army's grip on the empire was unassailable. Queen Victoria was so impressed that Maxim was awarded a knighthood. But machine guns, like all new developments, were at their most effective when the opposition didn't have them. And by 1914, the turkey shoot was over. The First World War was kicking off, and the Germans had machine guns too. Suicidal cavalry charges were quickly abandoned. The machine gun had changed the face of battle. It led to trench warfare and bogged everything down. Now a new weapon was needed to clear the trenches and open it up again.
To clear a trench, you need to fire at close range. So a chap called Colonel J. Thompson developed this, a submachine gun, small, light, portable. You could fire it from the hip, you could fire it from your shoulder, you could fire it, if you wanted, from the back of your Buick. This is the Tommy gun. These are mine here. One, two, three, four, five, those are mine, and then this is where the army are going, really. You can see some of the younger recruits up here, and then into my shots. That's good.
Colonel Thompson's gun was developed too late for World War I, but by World War II, submachine guns were commonplace. The Tommy gun and all its variants were used to devastating effect in a new kind of warfare, fought not in clearly defined battlegrounds, but in streets and cities. On the Eastern Front, Germans and Russians fought a bitter war of attrition.
At Stalingrad, the Germans were losing 800 men for every street they captured. And things are no better today. To take a small village like this, you'd need a brigade, and that's 2,500 men. The army reckons that to capture one house, just like that, if it were well defended, they'd take 30 casualties.
To minimize their losses, the army practice what it calls fish, fighting in someone's house. Of course, just watching isn't good enough. It's been decided that I have to join in. Which means I need a crash course in the Army's Tommy gun for the new millennium.
Right, SA-80.
It is the right one.
And it's
those
got
are the
rounds
right bullets in it, and it has got it.
Now
I just,
in it.
I whack it in there.
Place it into the magazine housing.
Don't whack it.
And push up firmly until it clicks. Don't bang it up, push it up, and then push up until it clicks into position.
Are we happy that I've banged?
No.
We're not happy
we'll
with
do that again.
So push
place,
it up
place
gently.
It into the magazine housing, and then push it up into there, and then push up until you hear it click.
We're happy.
Put your hand over, take hold of the cocking handle.
Don't I want to open the door?
No, that'll open itself. Pull it to the rear, all the way to the rear, and then let it go forward under its own steam. Then tap the cocking handle forward, ensuring it's fully forward.
My arm is already getting tired from holding this. That's really properly heavy. I'd have a pistol.
You've got some baby watch when you finish things.
You are having a laugh. No, you really are having a laugh. Okay, let's kick ass.
Enemy in that building there. Entry point there.
Our mission is to secure the house next door by clearing it room by room. There are enemy soldiers in there, but we don't know how many or where they are.
Everyone happy with that? Cool.
I am completely out of my depth.
And then I'm going to launch assault pair one across. HR, 30 seconds.
Hey,
stand by.
HR, five,
we'll
four,
we'll
three,
and
two,
up at the top
one,
here.
Go.
It's a joke. Bloody Dora.
Don't let it go.
I'm not going to.
We're doing straight in.
Okay, go. F***ing hell.
The stun grenades and the gunfire are supposed to disorientate the enemy.
In where? Where? In where? Chuck it where?
But it's not doing much for me either.
Okay.
I've been in the house for less than a minute and I've been hit. This is nothing like it was supposed to be. I'm supposed to be forcing a cowering enemy to eat lead, but they've shot me. Having your head blown clean off doesn't sound quite as funny as it usually does. In a real situation, I'd be dead.
Let's go. You go first.
But this isn't a real situation, and I'm allowed to have another go.
Okay. Right, hang on. Oh, I'm so fat and old. Dead. I got dead. Wanna change mags? I'll change mags.
But unfortunately, they won't let me die.
Quite dead. It's not quite dead.
Joy of joys, I finally got a kill. Thing is, though, when you and the enemy have that much firepower, training and fitness can only do so much. This kind of urban warfare is like playing Russian roulette with a machine gun.
When you go into a house like that, you don't know your way around, you don't know how many people are going to be in there, you don't know what rooms they're going to be in. But in this day and age, you can be fairly sure what sort of gun they're going to have.
Since the end of the Second World War, one gun more than any other has established itself as the weapon of choice for revolutionaries, terrorists, and freedom fighters. It's an icon, a timeless classic, a symbol of revolution that's even been included in emblems and flags. It's the Kalashnikov, the AK-47.
With this gun set to fire a single shot, it's a rifle, and I could hit a man 500 yards away, no problem at all. But if I put it into automatic, turn it into a machine gun, well, let's see if I could hit that van, which is about 50 feet away. Here goes. Look at that. Not a single hole. Completely pristine. The bullets went everywhere except where I was aiming. And that's the thing. You see, with a rifle, you can kill one man. But with a machine gun, you can make a whole army keep its head down.
The automat Kalashnikov was designed by a Second World War Russian tank sergeant. Mikhail Kalashnikov was outraged by the imbalance of power between his side's single-shot rifles and the German infantry's automatic weapons. He was determined to provide the Soviet Union with a simple but reliable submachine gun. And he certainly did that.
The beauty of what he came up with in 1947, hence the name AK-47, is the simplicity. It fires at the same rate as a modern machine gun, around 600 bullets a minute. But if we take the back look, there's nothing in there. There's nothing to go wrong. You just pull the spring back, and then when you pull the trigger, some baler twine causes the hammer to go forwards. And look at all the gaps. You could fill this chamber with, I don't know, dust and grit and water and dead rats, and it would still work. That's the thing. An AK-47 can kill almost anything, but it's almost impossible to kill an AK-47.
It was standard issue for the Soviet army, but it soon spread and became the big player in all the hotter parts of the Cold War. The superpowers were fighting their battles by proxy, and the AK's simplicity made it better in the rough-and-tumble dirty wars than the more complex American M16. Soon the world was echoing to the bassy staccato beat of Sergeant Kalashnikov's brainchild. It's claimed that the AK-47 has already killed more people than both atomic bombs. At least 100 million have been produced, which means that every 60th person in the world has got one. It is undoubtedly the most popular gun on Earth.
Now, you might think Kalashnikov made a fortune from the AK-47, but actually, he didn't make a penny. He lives today on a state pension. But that might change very soon, because a German company wants to use his name on one of their products. An umbrella. Right. It really isn't exaggerating things to say that the Kalashnikov has altered the balance of world power. When your enemy has automatic weapons, it makes it much more daunting for even a superpower like the US to take on a small country like, say, Vietnam or Iraq. As British and American troops have found, urban warfare is the hardest thing in the world if the other side is armed with machine guns. You see, that's the problem with guns. The power they hand out is indiscriminate. Yes, they give power to the British Army and the police and security guards, but you can buy an AK like this for £60 these days, and that means the power is available to just about everyone.
A man's been shot dead and a woman injured after a gunfight.
Eight people have been injured after shot.
In the UK in 1994, there were 68 gun murders. In Germany, there were 380. In Japan, 39. In Switzerland, 36. But in America, the figure was 11,127. Here, where your right to have a gun is enshrined in the Constitution, there are more gun shops than petrol stations. Armed robberies are considered routine. But even the LAPD wasn't prepared for the outcome of a recent bank robbery in North Hollywood.
During the North Hollywood shootout, the initial responding officers, their weapons that they carried were the Beretta 92F 9mm. And in their patrol car, they had a 12-gauge pump shotgun. Now, the reason I bring this up is the 12-gauge pump shotgun is good for about 30 yards at best. What they went up against was a weapon like this that would hold a minimum of a 30-round magazine and is capable of shooting 500 yards with no problem at all. The bullet for this looks like this.
The gunman had AK-47s, handguns, a carload of ammunition, and full body armor. So outgunned, the police went shopping.
There was a gun store in the area. That gun store offered to our officers who were in the field a weapon like this that shoots a caliber close to this, so they could compete, they could combat it.
But even so, it took the LAPD 44 minutes to bring one of the gunmen down. The second gunman shot himself. The lesson the police learned was to get bigger guns. When bullets are flying around, what you really need is something to protect you. Kevlar can absorb the bullet from a handgun. But to stop the bullet from a high-velocity rifle, you need solid plates. There is, however, a drawback to these jackets. The protection that soldiers are asked to wear today weighs more than a medieval suit of armor. Small wonder that so many soldiers replace these Kevlar pads here with pieces of cardboard, especially as, look at this. This is the best disclaimer I have ever seen. Whoa. This armor is not designed to protect the wearer against rifle fire or sharp or pointed implements. What? Like a pencil? And I thought a bulletproof vest was bulletproof. But then I thought that a cigarette case in your top pocket was more or less guaranteed to stop a bullet too. Seems not. Hollywood has taught us that petrol explodes when it's shot. It doesn't. We know for a fact that machine gun magazines last for at least the length of the movie. Wrong again.
and that the safest place to be in a shootout is behind a car door. Crikey. The sad truth is that being shot is very rarely only a flesh wound. Away from the glamour of the silver screen, real bullets in real people are truly devastating.
It causes a little teeny hole as it goes in, but as it exits, it may have an injury that's 7 inches across because of the fact that it's causing a blast effect of the surrounding tissues.
Steve Cohen knows all about gunshot wounds. Florida has over 600 gun deaths a year. That's more than the rest of the developed world combined.
Most people that are struck by a bullet are not struck in the act of some type of gangland violence or related to some kind of criminal act. What we see is a lot of people come in having been shot by a disgruntled girlfriend, wife, husband, or boyfriend.
The country that gave us the Western is also the country where there are 200 million guns. That's one for every citizen. Hollywood, it ain't.
You know, people often wonder if we spend a great deal amount of time fishing around for bullets. You know, like in the movies, you're always in there and the bullet comes out and they drop it and ding, and you think, oh, he's going to get well. We don't spend any amount of time looking for the bullet. In fact, most of the bullets are embedded somewhere that's not accessible without going through vital structures, potentially. So we leave the bullets alone unless they just reveal themselves to us.
Steve and his colleagues have a remarkable success rate with their gunshot patients. Only 10% die. But death is not the only problem brought about by the gun.
I think there's clearly a randomness to the outcome of a gunshot wound, depending on where the path of the bullet. If it goes through your heart, it may be the end of you. One person was shot in the head. It went basically in and out, didn't even cause a skull fracture. He went home. We had a woman last week that was shot a single time in the neck and ended up a quadriplegic. The old Dirty Harry question, do you feel lucky? All right, I mean, I guess that's really what it comes down to, and nobody likes to have their existence based on luck.
But thankfully, the odds are shortening. In the same way that Formula One motor racing supposedly provides the ordinary motorist with innovations like traction control, the trickle-down effect of war on civilian life has meant new surgical techniques, cleverer bandages, and state-of-the-art clotting agents. These innovations are, of course, good news for all of us. Not least because when your traction control fails and you end up speared on something sharp, the chances are that you'll owe your survival to the gun. However, although the theatre of war has given us new techniques for dealing with trauma, keeps on coming up with new and improved methods for inflicting it. Seems that very soon a bullet wound will need much more than a doctor. Because if the manufacturer's promotional materials to be believed, the gun has moved on.
Metal Storm takes ballistics from a 19th century mechanical operation to 21st century electronics with unprecedented performance, reliability, control, and safety.
Safety? Metal Storm makes Maxim's tree-felling machine gun look about as scary as a pointed stick. This gun, though the word gun seems somehow inadequate, has the unprecedented firepower of a million rounds a minute. It uses an electronic firing system, so the gun can be programmed to fire the bullets in pretty patterns,
or can overlap in flight, like a tight swarm of bees.
Those would be safe bees, you understand. Of course, if you're having a really bad day, you could just empty the entire hive in one go.
A single soldier can carpet the target area with 1,800 grenades, plus 360 heavy mortar rounds in just 0.25 seconds. enough to overwhelm a very serious threat.
And that's the future, the video game generation playing games with real weapons, just like at home. Computer, joystick, huge gun.
Stand by. Mark.
Guns up.
Certainly, it's unlikely that the soldier of tomorrow will do anything quite so tacky as actually hold his weapon. So, there we have it. An invention that has certainly changed the world. But for better or for worse. On the upside, we have street lighting, mass production, and advances in surgery. On the downside, an awful lot of dead people, and of course, no quagga. In a way, though, gun, good or bad, is a pointless question, because it's here to stay. Don't worry, though. Soon, only good people are going to be allowed to use them.
Introducing the world's first totally electronic handgun. This electronic ballistics technology can protect police officers by preventing a criminal from shooting an officer with their own gun.
Strangely, though, for me, this does represent a very small light at the end of the tunnel. Because computerizing the gun might change the world in a way that none of us were expecting. No more military coups, no more assassinations, possibly even no more war. Why? Well, if you put a simple mechanical device like this in the hands of a human, you've got a lethal combination. You put a computer in charge, it'll break down all the time. Good night.
It might be best known as a holiday destination, but behind the seafront there's another side to Southend in Essex, which is explored in Tower Block Dreams on BBC Three now.